Good morning. Welcome you to those that are here and are able to be here in person. We thank you for being here. And also those that are joining us through live stream, we thank you for being here. If you're visiting with us this morning, we want to welcome you. We thank you for being here and joining us. We pray that you'll have encouragement and great fellowship here. Just want to read a verse in Psalms 30, 12. To the end that my glory may sing praise to thee and not be silent, O Lord my God, I will give thanks unto thee forever. If you can stand and you're able to, let's stand and let's sing and give thanks to the God that's worthy of our praise and honor. Some announcements tonight at 5:30. We'll have kids access along with our life groups at various times and places. We'll be looking at the book of Philippians again, continuing in that book. Also at 6, right here in this room, we'll have our brother Ron Krotz. He will be speaking. So keep him in our prayers as well. Wednesday night at 7, we'll have our Thanksgiving service in person and also through the live stream. You won't want to miss this. I've been listening to some of these rehearsals. Man, I think it's going to be great, awesome, and it's got to be. So right after that, there's going to be some food, refreshments provided. So keep that in mind. Good food and fellowship go together. At this time, I would like to, if Ron McKay would come up, he has an announcement followed by Todd Apple.
The younger one was supposed to have come up here first, but that's okay. I will take it. Anyway, if anybody in the narthex has seen a flyer like this and are wondering what it is, can you play an instrument? Okay, it's all silent. That's good. But if you've noticed, we have plenty of instruments every Sunday morning, sometimes Sunday night. And the Lord has laid it on my heart to try to put together an instrument only festival time sometime next year in the spring. So you can't come up with the excuse that I don't have enough time to practice. You can bring it out of the closet or whatever it is, but how wonderful it would be to put together all instruments on a Friday night for praise to the Lord. So if you can and would like to, please sign up back there or see me. Thank you.
I always yield to my elders, so that's why Ron went first. And I'm going to break out my kazoo after that announcement, or my wash tub, and we'll see if we can get involved in that. How many of you know what's coming up December 3rd? Say it. Come on. The Christmas dinner. It's one of the highlights of our year. Every year we get together for one night of great food, fellowship, a challenging message, and this year we're going to have what someone has referred to as the Shannon Hills Chapel Rock Stars. Our men's quartet are going to be actually performing at the adults Christmas banquet. The reason I'm here today is the last day to sign up, and we don't want anybody to miss out. There's plenty of flyers in the back. They have names of people that you can hand them to. You don't have to pay today. And if you're 62 or older, you get to come for free. This is the one time that people are going to be lying about their age to be older so that they can come to the dinner. So we'd like everyone to participate. It's always a great time. Starts at 6:15, Saturday, December 3rd. See one of the couples on here and get your thing. At least fill it out and get it turned in so we can give our caterers the count. We look forward to seeing you all.
All right. Thank you, fellas. Any and all announcements, please look at your bulletin. You have all the details for this week and beyond. Please look at those. At this time, I'd like for anyone who has a birthday or anniversary to come up front and be recognized. I know there's got to be someone. Let's get this fine gentleman's name.
Sean Prince, and I'll be turning 39.
Awesome. It's all right. Okay, let's commit Sean to the Lord in our meeting as well. Our gracious Father, we're so thankful again for your loving kindness, your grace, and your mercy towards us. Father, we just want to lift up Sean to you, and also Malia and their children. Father, we just pray this year would be a great year for them. Father, we just know that they've been through a lot of transition lately. Father, we just pray that you would continue to help them and bless them, Lord. And Father, and do mighty things within them and their family, Father. We just pray. We lift you up. We know that you're a mighty God and you're able to oversee all things. And Father, we just want to commit this meeting to you. We pray for Mark as he preaches your word and presents it, Father, to our hearts. Lord, give us just allow us to drink it in, Father. Open our hearts to your word. Lord, we thank you. We love you. And we do pray for others that may have had birthdays or anniversaries this week. Lord, we just ask that you would be with them, give them a good year as well. And we commit this day, this meeting to you. We thank you. We love you. And give you all the praise and honor. In thy name we pray. All right, we are going to continue. If you can stand, please stand. We're going to continue our worship. Thought I heard something. Give our praise and honor to him. and song.
Amen. Wow, what can we say? What can we say? Well, we can say thank you, and it's a blessing to be able to say thank you with you, to be able to join together and express our love. Am I really loud? I sound like I'm really loud to me. Okay. Anyway, wasn't sure. Thank you. All right. whoever wore this last probably spoke at a more normal level. Yes, what a privilege to be able to thank the Lord with you. Bless that, and I appreciate the music that we're able to sing together, a variety of music written at different times by different believers to express our hearts, and we thank those who lead us in the music and work so hard to provide and to prepare that. Looking forward to Thanksgiving this week. Hope that you will be able to be out Wednesday night, as you've already been invited, and encourage you to do that. There's going to be a picture up here in a minute. I don't think they've totally forgotten me. They're still here. It's coming. It's coming. Oh, it's there. It's just not there. Okay. All right. I got you. There it is. Okay. I don't know how many of you will be pursuing a turkey for Thanksgiving. Hopefully you won't have to follow this young man's example and chase a turkey down, actually, on your farm. But some of you might. Some of you may actually have a turkey that you're going to slaughter. And if you do, more power to you. I'll say that. But maybe you're going to pursue a turkey at the grocery store, or maybe you're going to pursue one at a local restaurant, or maybe you won't even eat turkey. But, you know, I thought it was kind of interesting. Why do we eat turkey for Thanksgiving? Why do we pursue turkey at Thanksgiving? Well, there was an author, Sarah Josepha Hale. You know her better by being the author of Mary Had a Little Lamb. Mary Had a Little Lamb. But she was a prolific writer, and in 1827, she wrote a book entitled Northwood, A Tale of New England. And in that book, she devoted an entire chapter to a description of a New England Thanksgiving with a roasted turkey placed at the head of the table. And many people say it's her influence through that book that is the reason that a lot of us are eating turkey this Thursday and Friday and Saturday and Sunday. And according to the National Turkey Federation, I don't know if we have any members here this morning, but according to the National Turkey Federation, 88% of Americans eat turkey for Thanksgiving, accounting for some 46 million birds as the main dish for the holiday meal. So it's very likely that many of us here will be pursuing a turkey to cook, or even more likely, pursuing a turkey to eat. But we're not here to talk about pursuing turkeys, but rather pursuing God's pattern for His church. And thankfully, God's pattern for His church is not trying to elude us, as this turkey on the greeting card before you is trying to do to this young man. But even though God's pattern for His church is not trying to elude us, we still need to pursue it. We need to pursue it because of the hindrances to embracing His pattern when it comes to functioning as a local gathering of believers, because our enemies, the world, the flesh, the devil, all consistently present challenging obstacles to our successfully employing God's principles. And it's very easy to slip away into worldliness, tradition, laziness, peer pressure, or human wisdom. So in order to be faithful to God's pattern for His church, we must, as individuals and as a local church, we must be persistent in pursuing His pattern. We want to ensure that we are aligned with the pattern that God has provided for us in His Word. And that's why during 2022, we've been journeying through a series on this topic at least once a month, because the elders had chosen this topic as to be our theme for this year. And this morning we have reached the 14th of our 14 parts that we are investigating in this series. And you can see the 14 there before you on the screen. One Sunday in December, we will come back and somewhat review and recap and bring these all together. But this morning, we're going to be focusing on the 14th, and it's community involvement. Now, at first glance, you may think that community involvement is out of place in this list. As you look at the other topics there, you might say, how did community involvement get in this list? Admittedly, it's not something that you would find in a lot of similar lists, but I trust that our time in God's Word this morning will bring us all to united perspective that the local church's community involvement is, in fact, part of God's pattern for the church. You see italicized here on the screen before you, missions, evangelism, and community involvement. And those three really are tied very closely together. And you might say that missions is an extension of evangelism, going outside of our community. And I believe we're going to see community involvement is a real part of evangelism, or should be, according to the pattern that God has laid out for us in His Word. Our text this morning is going to be found in Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, and I invite you to turn there. Matthew chapter 5 is one of the three chapters, 5, 6, and 7, that consist of the recorded content of what is commonly known as the Lord Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. Now, this sermon was delivered sometime before the church was born in Acts chapter 2. So obviously it's not aimed directly at the church in the time that it was given. But the principles that we see in much of this sermon are repeated and applied to the church in the various letters that we have recorded in our Bibles. We refer to them often as the epistles. So we're going to be reading this morning Matthew chapter 5, and we're going to read verses 13 to 16, and our focus is going to be on verse 16. Matthew chapter 5, verse 13, "You are the salt of the earth." And this is the words of the Lord Jesus, by the way. "You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." Again, our focus this morning is going to be on chapter 5 and verse 16. And we're going to be examining words and phrases in this verse this morning to the extent that my hope for you is that by the end of this time, you will be able to quote Matthew 5, 16, if you can't already quote it. Because we're going to be looking at words and phrases. We're not going to go directly through in order, but that's my hope this morning. And so here's the outline that we're going to use to guide us in our examination of this part of God's pattern for His church. We're going to consider the basis for the local church's community involvement, the goal of the local church's community involvement, the need for the local church's community involvement, opportunities for the local church's community involvement, and then finally, commitment to the local church's community involvement. And in case you aren't completely clear on what we mean or what I mean by community involvement, it is simply the involvement of the local church in the community where the local church meets. Usually the neighborhood, the city, and the county where the local church gathers for meetings. So we're going to use, to work through this, Matthew chapter 5 and verse 16, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." So the first point that we're going to look at is this, the basis for the local church's community involvement. And this is what we're going to use out of the verse for the basis for our local church's community involvement. "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your works." before men that they may see your works. I'm going to get you to say that with me. Audience participation. Here we go. One, two, three. Before men that they may see your good works. Okay. The emphasis here is on good works that are evidence to people who see them. Now, we have here the first part of the phrase that we're looking at, before men. Now, the Greek word used in this verse for men is the Greek word that specifies human beings, not males only, not males primarily, but you could say before people, before humans, that they may see your good works. So, the good works, we're going to be looking a lot at this particular little phrase, these two words in English, two words in Greek, this morning, because it's really a key phrase that's going to connect this verse. The Lord Jesus is speaking to a Jewish audience in His Sermon on the Mount early in the book of Matthew during His ministry on the earth. And this is going to really connect our thoughts this morning out of Matthew 5:16 with our functioning as a local church. We're going to see it throughout the epistles as well as in the book of Acts. Galatians chapter 1 and verse 2, you don't have to turn there, but I just want to mention that verse because there Paul is writing to the churches of Galatia, the local churches, local groups of believers meeting together in different parts of the province of Asia. Over in Asia Minor, modern-day Turkey. And he writes to them these words, Galatians chapter 6 and verse 10. And I almost used Galatians 6:10 as my text this morning. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are of the household of faith. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are of the household of faith. And in that passage, and I really apologize for not having time to have you to turn there, but I'm going to have you turn there anyway. Turn to Galatians 6. I'm sorry. Galatians 6. If you have your Bible, if you don't, there's one in the pew there, but I would like you to see this. Galatians 6. While you're turning, I'll just mention this. As believers who desire to sow to the Spirit and reap everlasting life in our present experience, we should do good to everyone, especially other believers. Galatians chapter 6, look there at verse 10. Look at verse 9 first, if you will. And let us not grow weary while doing good. Can that be my encouragement to you this morning? Even as we get started, don't be weary in doing good. I know it can be wearying. I know it can be wearisome. But God says, don't be weary. And here's why we cannot be weary. For in due season, we shall reap if we do not lose heart. He's been talking in the earlier verses there in verse 7 about sowing and reaping. He was talking in verse 6 about sharing financially. And here he's speaking of investing our lives in the lives of others. There in verse 10, therefore, as we have opportunity, we'll come back to that opportunity later, let us do good to all, especially to those who are of the household of faith. So, just as I have a greater responsibility to provide for my own family than I do for other families, I have more responsibility to help the family of God than I do to help those who don't know the Lord personally through faith in Christ. But I do have a responsibility to do good to everyone, to all people, whether or not they are saved. It reminds me of the Lord Jesus' words of warning to the scribes and Pharisees in Matthew 23:23. He said, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin and have neglected the weightier matters of the law, justice and mercy and faith. These you ought to have done without leaving the others undone. And it's so easy for us to swing to one side, swing the pendulum to the one side or the other, and that's what we tend to do as human beings and as believers as well. So yes, we have a greater responsibility to care for each other. And we should do that. There's so many one another commands in the New Testament letters, and we need to take those to heart. And several years ago, that was our theme for the year. But in caring for one another, we need to be careful that we don't forget that we have a responsibility to care for those who don't know the Lord Jesus. In 1 Thessalonians 5:15, Paul writes this to the church at Thessalonica: "See that no one renders evil for evil to anyone, but always pursue what is good, both for yourselves and for all." We have a responsibility as believers in the Lord Jesus, ones who know Him personally by faith, that we have a responsibility to minister, to care for others. Again, personally, I'm not to neglect my family, but neither am I to neglect others. I'm to do good for fellow believers, but also for those who haven't believed. And good works involve action. That's why the word work is a part of this. Good works. Action that has value for others. And as those who know the Lord Jesus, who are in fellowship in a local church, we are to be involved in our community. Now, as I said about the pendulum, here's another swing of the pendulum. Much of the issue regarding the local church's community involvement is due to a wrong emphasis on what is known as the social gospel. The social gospel emphasizes addressing societal ills to the exclusion of being concerned about the sin sickness of humanity. Richard Niebuhr was a theologian who lived during the peak of the social gospel movement in the first half of the 20th century. And he wrote this summary of the social gospel. The social gospel is a God without wrath, bringing men without sin into a kingdom without judgment through the ministrations of a Christ without a cross. Now, clearly, such a philosophy is not God's pattern for the church. And by the way, Richard Niebuhr was writing that as a critique of the social gospel movement. It's not God's pattern for the church. And it's obvious why those who desire to pursue God's pattern would seek to avoid being mistaken for followers of the social gospel. God's primary concern is for the spiritual well-being of humans. That has always been true. It was true of Adam and Eve in the garden. It always will be true. So a local church must always be on guard against falling into such a deadly trap. But as we throw out the bathwater, it's dirty, right? We gave the baby a bath. We're throwing out the bathwater, and as they say, don't throw the baby out too, right? Pull the baby out and then throw the dirty water out. And likewise, we don't want to throw out community involvement just because those who follow a social gospel, and there are many today who follow this very path, who say that if we can get everything right in this world, then the Lord Jesus can come back. He is not waiting for us to get everything right. He has told us things are going to get worse and worse. So some people would say, on the other end, well, if it's going to get worse and worse, why are we even trying? Why don't we just sit around and wait for the Lord Jesus to come back? Some in Thessalonica were doing that, and Paul soundly rebuked them. Look over, you're here in Galatians, look at Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10, give us what clearly is the true gospel and its effects, not the social gospel. This is in contrast to the social gospel, that we just need to meet people's material needs and then things will be okay. No, we need to focus on people's spiritual needs, but simultaneously, we need to be concerned about the other needs of their lives. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 8, "For by grace you have been saved through faith." If you're here this morning and you are saved, If you have been forgiven of your sins, you have been saved by grace through faith. It's a gift of God. It's nothing that you or I have done. We do not deserve to be saved. We don't go out and get involved in our community. We don't go out and share the gospel so that God will accept our good works and let us into heaven. No, it took the death of the Lord Jesus. Christ with a cross. Christ on a cross. Christ dying for our sins. And coming down, being taken off that cross and buried and rising again and ascending back to heaven. All of that was necessary that we could be forgiven of our sins. For by grace, it's a gift. You have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. There's the gospel, okay? But there's an effect of the gospel. There's an impact of the gospel. Yes, we're going to heaven one day. Praise God. I hope it's today. I really do. I hope it's today. But in the meantime, what does verse 10 say? For we are His workmanship. We are His poem. We are His masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus for good works. For good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Should our good works impact our fellow brothers and sisters in Christ? Yes. Should we do good works for one another's benefits? Yes. But remember, Paul said to everybody, primarily, first of all, our family comes first, but we go outside of that. So beware of the social gospel, but don't allow avoidance of the social gospel to cause us to avoid involvement. And we can think about the Lord Jesus. He walked this earth as God in human form, perfectly sinless, perfectly accomplishing His Father's will in every aspect. He testified that He came to seek and to save the lost, to preach the gospel to the poor, to give His life as a ransom for many. But He also healed sick people, and He fed hungry people. And we're to be like the Lord Jesus, and to be like God the Father. Matthew chapter 5, if you'll go back over to Matthew chapter 5, and work your way on down through the sermon to verse 44. And the Lord Jesus said, "But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven, for He makes His sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust." God the Father is involved in the community. And those who don't know the Lord Jesus had the same sun rise on them this morning that you did, if you know the Lord Jesus. And the rain that He sent this past week was for the benefit of those who don't know Him, as well as those who do. God the Son is involved in the community, and God the Holy Spirit is involved in the community, including through the church, which was purchased with the blood of the Lord Jesus. Acts clearly demonstrates how the first churches cared for their own, but not just their own. Sometimes look up Acts chapter 9, verses 36 to 42, and read the story of Tabitha, a woman full of good works and charitable deeds, which she did. And among those good works and charitable deeds was making clothes for the widows. And the New Testament letters are peppered with references to good works. And these are not limited to community involvement, but clearly include community involvement. I've listed some of the verses here before you. Titus chapter 2 tells us that we're to be the Lord Jesus Christ's own special people, zealous for good works, excited about being involved in the lives of others. 1 Timothy 5:25, likewise, the good works of some are clearly evident, and those that are otherwise cannot be hidden. Romans chapter 13 tells us about how our involvement in the community and our testimony and our good works can impact even the government. Titus chapter 3 and verse 8, we're to be careful to maintain good works. These things are good and profitable to men. Again, that Greek word for people. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 24 and 25, and let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much more as you see the day approaching. Us gathering together is in the context of stirring each other up to love and to do good for others. We're to love one another. Community involvement is based on the instruction and the example of the one who is building his church with living stones who are to be like him. Based on the instruction and the example of the builder himself. Now that was a long point, and that's going to be the longest because we really need to lay that groundwork, because even now some here may say, I still don't, I'm not there yet, Mark. Well, and I understand, and I trust that as we continue through, you'll possibly be exhorted and encouraged in that area. The goal of involvement, you're here in Matthew chapter 5, look at verse 16. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. There's the goal of the local church's community involvement. Glorify your Father in heaven. Say that with me. 1, 2, 3. Glorify your Father in heaven. Amen. Our motivating goal in anything that we do in our lives should be to glorify God. We see in the New Testament, again, I have references I could give you, people watching the Lord Jesus and glorifying God as He heals a paralyzed man and forgives his sins, as He enabled mute people to speak and crippled people to be healthy and lame people to walk and blind people to see, and dead people to live. We read in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 12 that our conduct should be honorable among the Gentiles, among the unbelievers, that when they speak against us as evildoers, they may by our good works, which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. We don't do our good works in order that others may see us and pat us on the back and tell us how wonderful we are. But rather we do the good works that they may be seen, that others may glorify our Father in heaven. When our community, when our unbelieving community sees our good works, who gets the glory? That's the question. Psalm 115 verse 1 says, "Not unto us, O Lord, not unto us, but to your name give glory." This is not about us. This is not about, and that's our nature. We are self-centered, and I want to get the glory. My flesh wants the glory, but God the Holy Spirit living in us motivates us for our goal to be for God to be glorified, for people to see His work being done through us. No, we can't heal people. No, we can't give a blind person their sight, but we can serve them. And we can pray for them. And we can pray with them. And even for their healing if it is God's will. But when we humbly serve without expecting anything in return from those we serve, it can touch hearts and raise questions in minds. The Lord Jesus says in Luke chapter 14, talking to a man who had invited him to a dinner, and the Lord Jesus came to that dinner, and He said, "When you give a dinner or a supper, do not ask your friends, your brothers, your relatives, nor rich neighbors, lest they also invite you back and you be repaid. But when you give a feast, invite the poor, the maimed, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed, because they cannot repay you. For you shall be repaid at the resurrection of the just." You know, so often as we read scriptures like that, we make a proper spiritual application, because there are people who are spiritually poor, spiritually maimed, spiritually lame, spiritually blind, and that is an accurate application. But in doing that, we should not overlook the primary, the first interpretation, the Lord Jesus was speaking of people who are literally lame and maimed and blind and poor. And we praise God that He can use our service. As we read in 1 Peter 3, verses 15 to 17, "But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you with meekness and fear, having a good conscience, that when they defame you as evildoers, those who revile your good conduct in Christ may be ashamed, for it is better, if it is the will of God, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil." As we serve and are asked why, we have the opportunity to share the gospel, to point people to the Lord Jesus. Good works can build credibility for believers and can also open the doors for the gospel. Words are essential in communicating the gospel, but expressing kindness to those in need can demonstrate the gospel in works. The gospel in words and the gospel in works. God is glorified when we follow the Lord Jesus and allow His life. That's it, brothers and sisters. It's not us and our own strength saying we're going to go out and change the world. No, it's us coming and saying, "God, do with me what you want to do with me. Work through me, the life of the Lord Jesus, by your Holy Spirit, and use me in the way that you want to use me." When we show the gospel and when we say the gospel, God is glorified. And to an even greater degree, when someone is saved, when they hear the gospel, and that's our desire, that they will come to know the Lord Jesus. But whether they believe or not, we want God to be glorified. We want God to be glorified because one day God will be glorified even by those who have rejected Him. Every knee is going to bow. Every tongue is going to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God. And one day, it may be that our testimony, our words of witness to an individual who rejected God will be brought to testimony against him or her. And the works that we did in showing forth the Lord Jesus, not showing forth ourselves, but the Lord Jesus, will be brought to His glory. The goal of good works is glory to God. The goal of good works is glory to God. Thirdly, the need for involvement. I want you to notice the little phrase there in Matthew 5:16, "your light." Let your light so shine before men. Say that with me on three. One, two, three. Let your light so shine before men. See, you're getting it memorized. You said that. All you had two words, your light. The fact that the Lord Jesus uses the illustration of a light, what does that reveal about the world in which we live, the community in which we live? What does it tell you if He says you're a light? It means there's darkness, right? What good is a light if there's plenty of light? You need a light when there's darkness. Brothers and sisters, we live in a dark world. John chapter 3 and verse 19, the Lord Jesus said, "This is the condemnation, that the light has come into the world and men love darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil." In giving his testimony in Acts chapter 26, Paul said that he was commissioned by the Lord Jesus to go to the Gentiles and to turn them from darkness to light. We live in a world of darkness. 1 Peter 2:9 says that everyone who knows the Lord Jesus was called out of darkness into God's marvelous light. We lived in darkness, and this world is darkness. And now we know the Lord Jesus, the light of the world. And He says to us, "You are the light of the world. I'm going to reflect my light through you." Our community is dark. Spiritual darkness permeates our community. Therefore, your light. Notice those two words in this verse. Your light. Hear the Lord Jesus speaking to you. Your light. You see, your light is needed in our community. even during the day, even when the street lights shine brightly, spiritual darkness permeates our community. The darkness of people's hearts and the spiritual darkness that permeates our culture and all of the world system. Ephesians 6:12 talks about the rulers of the darkness of this age. This age in which we are living is a dark age. They're rulers, and they're not God. They're not angels. Well, they are angels. They're fallen angels, demonic angels. Satan is the prince of the power of the air, and light is needed. Your light is needed in our community. Your light is needed because your community is spiritually dark. Your light is needed. Number four, the opportunities for involvement. Back to our verse. Notice there again in verse 16. Let your light so shine. So shine. The verses before that remind us that a light is not doing any good if it's hidden, right? It's not doing any good if it's hidden. The Lord Jesus said, let your light so shine. Let it shine in this way. The purpose and character of light is to shine. Galatians 6:10, we read, therefore, as we have opportunity. Colossians 4:5 tells us to walk in wisdom toward those who are outside, redeeming the time. Cotton Mather, he was a Puritan theologian who lived in the early 1700s in New England. He said, the opportunity to do good imposes the obligation to do it. The opportunity to do good imposes the obligation to do it. Historically, Christians have been known as ones who went into areas and built hospitals and started orphanages and started schools and operated them. And many other good works. Often on the mission field, these are good works that open the doors of people's homes and of their hearts to the gospel, to listen, because again, credibility is being built. We've got so many ideas, and I don't have time to go through all of them, but just some of the ideas, ways that you can shine your light. And maybe you're already doing it, but there are schools. We desire to be back into the schools. We're trying to get an adopt-a-school partnership with Fraser Elementary right around the corner. It may not give us the opportunity, as we had with Christ for Kids, when we went in there and proclaimed the gospel. It may be a foot in the door. It may be an opportunity to do good works as believers, to show that we care about our community, and maybe that will open the door for opportunities. There's a ministry called City Help that Kim and I have gotten involved with that are seeking to bring Christ-honoring churches together to partner with different groups and needs in our community. International students. There's a ministry at UNCG and A&T that needs people to bring food for meals, that needs people to be a mentor, to help people with English conversation. There are the homeless we're seeking to minister to through the urban ministry, the tiny house ministry. We're praying about that. It's one of our ministries of the month this month. We'd encourage you to check out some of these different ministries. Nursing homes, seeking to minister to the elderly. Health needs. We had a Red Cross blood drive here several years ago, seeking to show our community, we care about you, and you're not just a notch on our belt. No, we care about the whole person, and we know that primarily they can get healthy and still go to hell. That's not what we want, but we want to be involved in our community with the gospel. Food banks, food programs, adopt a highway program, cleaning up ministries to immigrants and refugees, parenting classes, pregnancy care ministries, employment opportunities and training. We have endless opportunities to represent the Lord Jesus in actions and word as we act like Him in His power, as we speak of Him in His power. So the last commitment, or the last point, is the commitment to involvement. It's the very first word in the verse, let. Let your light so shine before people. We've got to do it. We've got to make a commitment. We can read about it. We can talk about it. We can pray about it. But we need to act. Lights need to shine before people. So, first of all, the question comes to you between you and the Lord. Are you convinced that community involvement is part of God's pattern for His church? As one writer put it, out of the seat, on the street. But our light's not just to shine here. Our light's to shine at our job, in our community, in our neighborhood. And how can we be involved as a local church? And if you are convinced, will you pray about how and where? Let your light shine. Even though it requires sacrifice, I want to encourage you that evangelism is not words or works, but rather words and works. Do good works, praying that God will use those works to open eyes and open minds and open hearts, and watch for opportunities. As you are involved in the community, watch for opportunities to open your mouth with words about Christ from you when people open their eyes to the words of Christ through you. Let's pray, then we'll have just a verse of a song to be played. I'd encourage you to really meditate on this, to pray on this. We would like to know other ways that we can be involved as a local church and how you could help us in doing that. Let's pray. Father, thank you for being involved in our community. Thank you for coming, Lord Jesus, to seek and to save the lost. Thank you for coming and showing your love for humanity. Lord Jesus, by the things that you did, but ultimately and primarily by giving your life at Calvary. And Lord, that's our heart for those in our community. We want them to know the gospel. We want opportunities to share the gospel. Father, please open doors for us and help us to be bold and to walk through the doors and to speak the gospel, to share our testimonies of what you have done in our lives, how you have changed us, how you have come to seek us and you've saved us. And it was not by our works, but rather it was by grace through faith. And now we want to do good works. We want to do things for others. We want to let our light so shine before men that they may see our good works. And Father, we want them to glorify you. Convict us when we do it for our own glory. Father, we pray that you'd work in our hearts. We yield ourselves to you. We place our bodies, those of us who know you personally as Savior, we place our bodies on the altar as living sacrifices. Do with us as you will. And Father, for any here who do not know you, Father, might they hear your word and be convicted of their sin and be drawn to the Lord Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. May the Lord encourage you.